paranormal activities, government conspiracies, cryptozoologies. I made that word uppities. It's Anomalous Realities on Revolution Radio.
You see things.
Yeah.
I don't know where I am.
In the space that's outside of the physical reality.
Experiences, unusual experiences. I call them movies.
Yeah. It's crazy. It
would start moving. Zip from one place to the other.
And he showed me a number of things. He showed me some episodes from a few of my previous lives.
Joining us tonight on Anomalous Realities is special guest, UFO researcher and lecturer, David Marler.
Good evening, everyone, and welcome to Anomalous Realities. I am your host, Lenita Elder, and with me in studio tonight, as always, is Marky Mint. How are you doing tonight, Marky?
Good evening. Doing well. Thank you for having me. I'm very interested in today's subject.
Yes. Tonight we have, well, first of all, we have Melina in studio with us. Melina, how are you doing?
I'm doing great. Happy Friday. I'm excited about the show, too. Can't wait to get started.
Good to have you back. It's good to have you back. It's been an interesting week. And I just want to say real quick that, you know, my thoughts are going out to all the people in Paris right now. Another tragedy yet again. And it's just terrible. I can't even right now. But tonight we have with us David Marler, who is an author and a UFO investigator who has been, I believe, interested in UFOs most of his life. David, welcome to the show.
Thank you very much, Lenita, and happy Friday to everyone.
Yes, happy Friday. The weekend is here.
Finally.
Yay. because I understand that you have been interested in the UFO phenomenon most of your life. So how did that interest come about for you?
Well, actually, it goes all the way back to the year 1973. I was 5 years old at the time. And my first exposure to the term UFO that I can recall as a child was around the spring of that year. There was a wave of sightings that were occurring in southeast Missouri near a small little sleepy town called Piedmont, Missouri. And in the St. Louis, Missouri area where I was growing up, a lot of local media, both newspaper and television, had focused on this little sleepy town tucked away down there in the southeast corner of the state because they were having an unprecedented wave of UFO sightings. And this involved lights, objects seen in a Clearwater Lake, objects going in, coming out of the lake, just very bizarre reports. And what was really interesting about that was one of the primary witnesses the first night actually involved the sighting of a UFO by the basketball coach for the local team and a number of other adults that were with the basketball team coming back from a neighboring town. And I remember my father saying that the lead witness was in fact his best friend growing up, because he grew up just in a neighboring town, back in the 30s and the 40s down there. And I remember him saying that if this man said he saw something, he saw something. I grew up with him. He's very matter of fact. And I remember the excitement of my father and my older siblings piling in the car, driving down from St. Louis down to Piedmont, Missouri to go, quote unquote, look for UFOs, which a lot of people were doing at the time. And in fact, it ultimately led to the physics professor for Southeast Missouri State University, Dr. Harley Rutledge. He went down there thinking he was going to debunk or explain away all of these crazy UFO stories.
Right.
And in fact, he wrote a book. It's a collector's item now called Project Identification. And he went in as a skeptic, but came away having witnessed things himself at that time. So it really goes back to 1973. And then 4 years after that, my sister and her husband had a close encounter with a UFO literally right over their vehicle just outside Kansas City, Missouri. And so it's one thing to hear of stories about other people, but when your sister has a dramatic incident like that, it really just continued to reinforce my interest growing up in the UFO subject. And in 1990, my interest went from, purely academic or, casual interest to active investigation and research.
Now, how did that come about?
Actually, by accident. My mother was reading a newspaper article, local newspaper article, and it was profiling the Mutual UFO Network, or MUFON, in the state of Illinois. And I was reading the article, and it obviously rekindled the interest that I already had.
Yeah.
And realized that the assistant state director lived just about 5-6 miles down the road from where I lived. So I looked him up, made a phone call. I went there with my father, who's now deceased, but he still had an active interest in 1990 in the UFO subject. And I think we probably sat there for 5 or 6 hours discussing the subject till the late night hours. And, you know, after that, there was just no turning back. It was fascinating that, wow, there's actually organizations that actively investigate this. I want to be part of that. I would like to see something myself if possible. So, ultimately, I joined MUFON and, eventually took over as the Illinois state director for about 8 years and conducted investigations in that portion of the country for MUFON. Mm-hmm. And, it was during my time as state director that I investigated one of the more well-documented cases involving these triangular UFOs back in January 2000 that involved multiple police officers not only observing this triangular object, but that were in radio contact with one another while the events played out.
Wow. I mean, that has to be one of the most, I guess, interesting, you know, cases because of the people involved with it. And it wasn't just a single officer. Weren't there multiple police officers involved in that?
Yes, there were four officially. Unofficially, there were five, because during the course of my investigation, I was calling all the neighboring municipalities, reaching out to the police departments. And there was one officer that we were never able to name, but one of the police dispatchers that I reached out to, she made the comment, "Oh, you need to talk to our police officer. She saw that object as well." And repeated attempts to go to the police station, email, leave messages, was met with absolute silence. She never came forward. We never knew the name of that police officer. But we do have the four other police officers that were on record, as well as a number of civilians, that also saw the object. And, of course, it passed in very close proximity to Scott Air Force Base, which is very interesting as well. No reports of it taking off or landing at Scott Air Force Base. Right. I always like to emphasize that point.
I've noticed that there seems to be a lot of UFO activity around military bases. Actually, my husband's first UFO sighting happened near a military base. There was a Fort McCoy is in Wisconsin, in between Tolma and Sparta. Mm-hmm. And there is also a drive-in theater that is right not too far away from the military base. Now, we were at this drive-in theater. This was 1997. And near the end, right before it was ready, everybody was getting ready to leave, saw this weird glow out of the corner of my eye. And I thought it was headlights or something. But as it gets closer, it's much brighter. And it was probably, this thing was about the size of a Volkswagen, but it was a perfect sphere. And it was metallic and gold and almost kind of fluid looking, which is, it's funny that we were able to determine, because my husband turned and looked at the same time I turned and looked. It's like we both kind of saw it because it went right next to us. It was like above the ground, maybe 3 feet, above the ground, went right next to us within about 10 feet and then shot up into the air at about a 90 degree angle. And then it was just like gone in seconds. Like out of sight in seconds from that. And you know what the weird thing is, you know, we didn't really pay attention to whether or not other people had seen it, because the first thing we were doing is just looking at each other, and we both were like, what the hell was that? And
a common reaction.
Yeah, it is. And we had my younger cousins with, which was actually the first time I had met them, because they were part of my native family, which I don't know a lot about because my father was adopted. And so they were with us, and my younger kids were with us, and they were all really young at the time, so a lot of them don't remember this. But my husband is very logical and very skeptical of everything, and he's the kind of person that he won't jump to a conclusion. But that was one of those things that to this day, all he can say is that He has no idea what it was. he'd like to say that he thinks it might be military, but he knows better.
Yeah.
It had an illumination to it, but there were no lights on it. It's hard to explain. But actually, here's the weird thing. This was 97. In 98, the movie Sphere came out, and the thing looked bigger than the thing that we saw. Okay, much bigger, but it looked almost exactly like what we saw, which made me wonder if Michael Crichton was getting his inspiration from somewhere.
Well, at least the skeptics can't say that you saw that and then you suddenly looked up in the sky and you imagined you saw the same
right.
thing. Right. You witnessed this before the movie.
Before the movie, yeah. So,
fascinating.
Yeah.
Absolutely fascinating. The spheres, you know, the various shapes have been reported. Obviously, UFOs come in all shapes and sizes. I focused a lot of my time on the triangular UFO research, mm-hmm. but I have lots of reports of spheres and other types of objects, egg-shaped objects that have been reported, you know, worldwide going back, you know, decades, if not centuries. And yeah. it really is amazing when you look at the myriad of shapes and
yes.
sizes that are reported. And, you know, in some cases, you know, finding characteristics beyond just the shape that are specific mm-hmm. to certain UFOs. And so, you know, you do start to see patterns in the data. And that was one of the things that prompted me to focus on the triangles, is because there appeared to be characteristics that were consistently there in the various narratives, not just here in the United States, but worldwide.
Right. Now, I remember you in the book, you covered something about some historical triangular shape UFOs. Could you share a
yes.
little bit about that?
Yes. Well, I mean, let's be honest. The most practical explanation, if one was to see one of these large triangular UFO, you know, shaped or triangular UFO mm-hmm. objects, would be that it's something military.
Right.
I investigated the January 5th case when the reports initially started pouring in. Mm-hmm. The most practical explanation, as I told people, was it was probably something military. And I was, you know, willing to at least acknowledge that as a possibility. But immediately when I was interviewing these police officers in the various police stations, my mind was going back to the eyewitness descriptions by the gendarmes in Belgium 10 years prior, from November of 89 to spring of 91. And as these officers were tracing out their sketches and as they were describing the flight characteristics, and in some cases the lighting patterns, I was having flashbacks, thinking to myself, this is exactly what was reported in Belgium. And none of these police officers had an active interest in the UFO subject. Another thing that I always like to throw out to the skeptics that say, well, these people believed in UFOs, therefore they went out and they saw something unusual in the sky, and it was basically, you know, just confirming their preconceived belief systems. They wanted to see a UFO, therefore they did. Well, none of these officers thought that what they saw was extraterrestrial. Most of them said, yeah, we just saw something unusual, but we thought it was probably military.
Right.
But to your question, what really amazed me after this investigation is I have a large library, one of the largest libraries on the subject, and mm-hmm. I have a lot of historical material going back to the 1800s. And I had numerous reports of large triangular objects with similar lighting characteristics, demonstrating similar flight dynamics, going back at least to the 1940s and 1930s, and even the earliest reports going back to 1881 in Connecticut were two astronomers, as written in Scientific American, observed two triangular black notches moving across the lunar surface. And they described them as being so large that they obliterated nearly a third of the moon's surface as they were, you know, apparently moving over the moon's surface. So we have that account. Wow. We have cases going back to the 1930s. We have cases going back to the 40s. And at some point, you at least have to concede that some may be military, but there is clearly a history here of these reports. And the reports are fascinating. There's one from 1960 in Connecticut. In fact, I include that in the book. There's a graphic. And you look at that sketch that was in the local newspaper, and it is identical to the reports that we're getting today. A triangular object with a light, large light at each point, and a strobing or pulsing light in the center. And if you delve into that report, even the flight characteristics, the stop and go motion, the way that the object would make acute right angle turns from a dead stop and hover accelerate, decelerate, and the absence of sound. That's one that consistently plays out time and time again, is the absence of sound in these reports. And that was reported in 1960. In fact, the witness stated the eeriest part of the entire experience was the complete absence of sound.
Wow. I mean, yeah, that's one of the things that kind of make it a little bit more difficult to try to call it something modern, something that, you know, we could have come up with, because from what we understand, I mean, all of our engines make a certain amount of noise. They have to, because of the type of engine that they are.
The ones that we're aware of do.
But even, I mean, going back so far, you know.
I can see that I don't know what the state-of-the-art technology is. I don't think any of us do. I'm sure that's still classified. Mm. But at the very least, what we can do, and as I've often stated, I can't make a scientific argument for the existence of these things, namely because we don't have any really hard data as far as pieces of the craft or anything of that nature. But what I tried to do was put together a historical argument showing multiple documentation, newspapers worldwide, news service wire stories, declassified documents. And actually, Lenita, that's one of the most interesting things. Some of the most dramatic reports come out of the government's own files, mm-hmm. both here in the United States with Project Blue Book, as well as the declassified MOD files. And a number of those, and as I've often said, I wouldn't be interested in UFOs if it was just eyewitness accounts, but a number of those in the military files from both the UK and the United States involve radar confirmation. Mm-hmm. So at least at certain times, these things apparently reflect radar waves. And there was a case that I profiled in a Smithsonian Channel documentary I participated in recently. And it was a case in 1953. So again, we're going back. Mm-hmm. And we had an Air Force pilot that saw this unusual light. And he at first thought it was maybe a star or a planet, but just, you know, extremely brilliant in nature. But the one thing that he noticed was it apparently had this very sharply defined edge to it, not like a star that kind of scintillates and twinkles where it has kind of a fuzzy edge. It seemed to have a definitive circular shape. So he decided to increase altitude. He thought, well, if it's a star or planet, if I increase, you know, altitude, mm-hmm. it's not going to change perspective. If it's something within the atmosphere, then perhaps it might get larger in my windscreen.
Yeah.
Within a matter of minutes, he realized that the light that was above him was now below his jet aircraft.
Oh, wow.
He then decides to go ahead and decrease altitude and close on the object. And this is detailed in the Air Force Project Blue Book report.
Right.
As he closed on the light, it began to oscillate, red, white, and it was flashing in sequence. Then in the report, the pilot states that the light then changed into a perfect equilateral triangle, which then, as if he couldn't wrap his mind around that, then divided into two triangles, which shot off in different directions and disappeared. Now, the interesting thing about that, one could say, well, that's absolutely insane. Who would believe a story like that? Well, the Albany, Georgia airport did, because they were tracking an unknown target on radar at the exact same location and time that this pilot had his sighting.
Wow. That is just wild, honestly. You know, we've had a lot of things disclosed as far as, you know, technologies that we have. But if it's in their files as something that's unexplainable, doesn't it make sense that it probably isn't something we've created?
Well, you would certainly think
You'd
so. The Air Force certainly did their best to try to explain away all of these reports, although there is a pretty large subset of reports that are still labeled as unknown. Mm-hmm. Now, as if the sighting isn't dramatic and almost unbelievable enough, I think the most unbelievable aspect of this story is what the Air Force came up with as far as an explanation for this pilot sighting. They determined that he saw the planet Venus.
Oh, come on.
Which
is interesting. The planet Venus was underneath him?
Venus is underneath his jet, and it's also being tracked on radar. So
it splits into two objects.
As I've often said, for researchers, you know, despite the Air Force's perspective on the UFO subject and trying to just come up with the most ridiculous explanations, mm-hmm. I always tell people there's still a wealth of case material and eyewitness reports in those files. So I look at the reports and I discount the explanations. I could care less what the Air Force says. I'm going to make up my own mind, and I would encourage my readers to make up their own mind when they review those reports.
Yeah. Well, there is quite a bit available that's been released by the FBI lately. I've seen lots of files, and I don't think all of them were Blue Book related. I'm pretty sure that there were some FBI files recently that were released that I don't think they were, I'm not sure. sure that they were craft related, but there was a document that was speaking about dimensional beings that were visiting us.
And I have not seen that one.
I've got to get you. I'll have to find that and get you the link, because it goes to the FBI website and takes you to the file.
Well, there are thousands and thousands of pages, and I think I've gone through most of them, at least at a cursory glance, and trying to put the book together and trying to gather up and collate all of these triangular UFO reports. What I also found interesting is when you start laying all of this data out, and I mean, it was just, I was basically swimming in data trying to put all this together, and it's so hard to try to select what cases to include in the book. I try to focus on multiple witness cases because I think they hold a little bit more merit in most people's eyes versus just a solitary witness seeing something, much like you and your husband. You didn't only see it, your husband saw it as well.
Exactly.
So, you know, I think people are intrigued by that. But there were mass sightings of these triangular UFOs going back decades. In the 1950s, there was a news service wire story about numerous triangular UFOs being seen in the sky by hundreds of West Berliners. And they even interviewed one of the directors of Tempelhof Airport at the time that confirmed that these sightings were occurring. And that was in the 1950s. Also in the 1950s, specifically November of 1957 to the spring of 1958, Denmark was inundated. They had a deluge of triangular UFO reports that were actually being investigated by the Danish Defense Intelligence Service. And this was written up in the local newspapers of the time. And what's really intriguing is they were taking the reports quite seriously, and they stated that they had been flooded with so many reports that they couldn't keep up with them all. One occurrence that occurred in spring of 1958 was actually written up by one of the international news service agencies, and it described the fact that over the village of Brohier in Denmark, a woman had reportedly observed a large, black, silent, hovering triangle over the village. Now, that bears striking similarities to some of the modern reports.
Right.
But it goes on to state that reporters confirmed with at least 20 other villagers that they had observed the same thing. In addition to seeing the triangular object hovering silently, they also observed these objects that were coming out of the triangular UFO, smaller objects. And this is one of the characteristics. We have objects or lights exiting these triangular UFOs and entering the triangular UFOs. So there's some type of interaction with other, as I like to call them, non-triangular UFO objects. So, what's going on there, we don't know. But what was interesting is laying all this information out, when the Danish wave was occurring, the week that it started in Project Blue Book files, we had two UFO sightings within a 48-hour period of time while the Danish wave was starting over Wisconsin and northern Illinois, as reported in Project Blue Book files.
Really?
And in one of the reports, it stated that the triangular object was at least 200 feet in length. Now, this is 1957, but doesn't that bear striking similarities to what we hear today?
Yeah.
Estimates of 200 to 300 feet long and triangular.
That's another thing about it, is the sheer size of these UFOs.
Absolutely. In fact, I've come up with a term, and I've had a couple of researchers quote me. They say, can I use that? I'm like, yeah, it's not copyrighted. Knock yourself out. But I refer to these triangular UFOs as unambiguous UFO sightings. A lot of UFOs might be a little streak of light in the sky, and you have to sit there and think, did I see that? Or what did I see? These triangular UFOs, there's no question what the witnesses observed. I mean, they can sometimes see them for an extended period of time. They obliterate a large portion of the sky. They're more often than not, I would say at least 90% of the time, extremely low altitude. In fact, the January 5th, 2000 case, estimated altitude of this object or objects, as now we're reevaluating the case, we estimate it was between 500 to 1,000 feet altitude. Very, very low.
Wow. Now, are they... Military planes, how low are they allowed to fly legally?
Well, they have...
On civilian airspace.
Yeah, they have a ceiling within residential areas, and then I think it actually expands into the rural areas.
Mm-hmm.
But I believe it's somewhere between 500 to 1,000 within that range. So it depends on the type of aircraft as well.
Right.
These objects, to your point, are extremely large. In fact, one of the police officers, he stated that he was a military, self-described military brat growing up. moving from Air Force Base to Air Force Base. And he stated to me, and he stated in subsequent interviews, every aircraft that I've seen makes some type of noise. This object made no noise. And I was actually on location with him on this small county road outside of Lebanon, Illinois. Mm-hmm. And I'm familiar with the area because I grew up there. I mean, where this incident played out was roughly 20 miles from where I lived at the time. So virtually in my backyard. And it was one of those areas, Lenita, where you can stand outside on a late night and quite literally hear a pin drop. It's extremely rural, extremely flat. Mm-hmm. And yet this object was hovering directly above him and it made no noise. He observed the object make a flat pivot turn. In other words, it didn't bank like a conventional
aircraft. Right.
But it made a flat turn on the horizontal plane and then rapidly accelerated. And we've been able to get a rough estimate of the acceleration. Suffice it to say, this thing went supersonic, and yet there was no sonic boom.
Right. Now, and that's another thing. I mean, that's literally, that's defying the laws of physics as we know them.
Exactly.
On planet Earth.
And what's interesting about that is the same thing happened in Belgium during their wave of sightings. The object was tracked on radar by the Belgian Air Force pilot Yves Mielberg, and he tracked the object multiple times. He locked on multiple times, but each time he locked on, the object apparently, as if an evasive maneuver, accelerated and made tremendous gyrations in midair. And a number of those occurrences, they were able to document the object went supersonic, yet no one on the ground or anywhere else reported a sonic boom.
Huh. That's very interesting. You know, I have to bring this up real quick. And I know this isn't like a UFO sighting. And this is, we had these storms the other day.
Mm-hmm.
And they had a surrealistic lightning. And this is where the weird part is, I had a dream about this kind of lightning the night before this happened. But this lightning, it was hitting multiple times in the same place. It was very large, very thick. And here's the weirdest part is that even though it was very close, I mean, it hit within a half a mile, there was no thunder.
Hmm.
And we were freaked out by this a lot. And you know, we were trying to figure out, I mean, how do you have lightning that has no thunder?
Exactly. Well, and it seemed to be hitting in the same place as well. What's the old adage? Lightning doesn't strike twice.
Exactly. Everything about that storm was just very, very strange. Very strange.
You do get purely electrical sort of thunderstorms. So in France, I remember seeing many in France where you hear no thunder whatsoever.
Really?
Lots of lightning. They're quite spectacular visual shots. But if it's striking the same place twice, then, yeah, what was that film? War of the Worlds, wasn't it?
Right. Well, that was the thing, is because in the dream that I had the night before this bizarre lightning storm happened, I saw this lightning come out of what seemed like a very large, thick cloud. And it was the lightning was extremely thick, and it was like twisted, really thick, but here's the thing. It struck a single spot for like several minutes. Okay, that was the part in the dream that was really weird. But this lightning did, it lasted long too, but it was nothing like that. Obviously, that was dream version, but it was the whole thing was just surreal. And the kids and I were actually wondering, you know, if this was maybe weather modification happening that we were seeing or something. It was very strange. And some of the thickest of the lightning was coming from very thin clouds that didn't even look like storm clouds. Like there was barely any cloud coverage at all when this came out of there. So it didn't seem like it should be so highly charged. But, you know, I'm not a weatherman, so.
Interesting, though.
UFOs have been known to take interest in storm clouds and, you know, electrical charge, have they not?
Absolutely. Yeah, we had a famous case here in New Mexico back in 1995 involving an America West flight, and they were flying through some storm clouds, and then this large thunderhead, when the cloud would illuminate, they saw this cigar-shaped UFO, and it was estimated to be extremely large and had a white strobing light that was moving counterclockwise across it. And we have, with the cooperation of the FAA, we have the radio transmissions between the airline pilots, Albuquerque Air Traffic Control, as well as Cannon Air Force Base, and ultimately NORAD, who they called in. And it was a very dramatic case. But to your point, Marky, it had this UFO that almost seemed to be hovering within this thundercloud. And they could only really see it clearly, the silhouette of the object, when the lightning flashed and the cloud had illuminated. Very, very eerie case. But again, one that was tracked on radar. They contacted Cannon. Cannon Air Force Base said they didn't know what it was. And then they contacted NORAD. And NORAD just said, well, no, you know, we're not tracking anything. And about 5-10 minutes later, Albuquerque Air Traffic Control gets a call back from NORAD, and they say, hey, where did you say that object was being reported? And they, you know, relayed the coordinates, and they said, well, hey, we're tracking a search only target up around that area that you just described, and they've been tracking it now for about 5-10 minutes. And so a very dramatic case, but one, to your point, that apparently involved some heavy electrical activity in the upper atmosphere.
Definitely. Yeah. No, that's cool. There is something about it. I don't know. I mean, it's not like us on the ground beneath the storm is going to see what's going on above it. But there's also that well, I don't know if it's famous, but there's that old video, I think, of like a NASA control room where they're sort of studying something with some storm clouds or a typhoon or something. And you see like these circular UFOs going into it or coming out of it. It's very odd. But yeah, I definitely think there's something to it.
Yeah. I did find a link for that for the FBI document. I put it in the Skype chat, and I also put it in the chat room for the radio station. So the listeners out there, you guys can check out that FBI site. It's on the vault.fbi.gov site, and I put the link in there. So you can look that over later at your leisure and check that out. Yeah. Now, have you actually had a personal sighting?
I wish I could say yes. Unfortunately, the answer is no. And wow. I always like to say it's not for lack of trying. I think I'm a UFO flea and tick collar, because wherever I go, it seems like the UFOs quickly disappear. Wow. I actually was involved with the Missouri chapter of the Mutual UFO Network, or MUFON, back in the early 90s. They were having an unprecedented wave of UFO sightings, cattle mutilations, in the early 90s, really all the way up until the mid-late 90s, but it was really in the early 90s we first started investigating it. And we were interviewing Missouri Highway Patrol that had seen these lights, and Webster County Sheriff's Department in Missouri that were investigating the cattle mutilations and UFO sightings. And we were actually coordinating with the local sheriff at the time, telling him that, you know, we're going to be out at night, we'll keep an eye on some of the farmers' fields. And we were camping out in fields where the weekend before they were having mutilated cattle found. So we were trying to go where the action is, essentially, and setting up with cameras, infrared equipment, parabolic recording microphones, night vision gear, you name it, we had it. And wherever the activity went, you know, in the subsequent weeks that followed or months that followed, that's where we would go and we would set up. But we never were able to actually witness something firsthand, unfortunately.
That's a shame.
And it's hard to do. You know, we can't often do that. When you have sporadic reports, it's hard to know where you're supposed to be. But when you have a relatively small geographic area where you're having a wave or a concentrated, you know, wave or flap of sightings, then it gives you, an area that you can work with. And then you can essentially lay it out and have multiple teams set up in radio contact with one another. So
right.
I'm hoping we'll have another wave of sightings somewhere soon in that respect. And again, a small geographic area. Some of the states that I've been talking to, most recently just today, I was talking to someone about sightings in Tennessee. Apparently they're having a huge wave of triangular UFO reports in that area. Hmm. And but it's my understanding is it's kind of spread throughout the state. But if you can get, say, a 10, 20 square mile area where they're having activity, that's something that you can work with as an investigator and try to set up and capture something real time.
Have you ever been out to the Gilliland Ranch, James Gilliland?
I have not, no.
I've heard a lot of people say that, you know, they see things out there. I don't know. I've seen some video from it. I'm not 100% convinced, but I haven't been out there myself. So I think you actually have to, you know, go there firsthand and check it out. But apparently people see things in that area very, very frequently. What I have found personally is they usually show up when you least expect them.
Exactly.
I've had a lot of sightings in my life, and actually the lion's share of them have been within the last 10 years. You know, prior to 97, when we had the mutual sighting at the drive-in, I had only had one sighting in my life, which was 1995, I believe, or around then. And it was pretty dramatic one too, but I had a lot more in the recent years, and my kids have seen a lot of them, and they're always different. That's the strange thing, is they're always different. Sometimes, you know, they're red lights in the sky that are like stationary and then switch places with each other back and forth. Sometimes they are like, the way the kids describe that one is really hard. It's almost like an upside down light bulb. Hmm. It was black. And this was when we lived in Tulsa, and it was near, I mean, it was over the city, which is one of those things. We actually had discussed this on the show a while ago, but there was a discussion, and we were talking UFOs during the show that night, and there are times when there is a UFO sighting and some people will see it and some people won't. Oh, and there was actually a discussion that perhaps some people, like, they have the ability to control who sees them and who doesn't see them. Mm-hmm. When they're, you know, not obviously military. Well, I almost wonder if the military can't do that too. Who knows?
Well, there were a number of news stories. This is going back approximately 4 to 5 years. I'm sure we could probably pull it up on YouTube and find mm-hmm. it, where I believe it was CNN and Fox News both were running a news story, and they were talking about invisibility technology and that we do have the ability to cloak both ground right. vehicles as well as air vehicles. And I've been meaning to actually, it's funny you mentioned that, Lenny, because I've been meaning to research that. I saw it, you know, 4 or 5 years ago, probably at least, but I've been wanting to kind of pull that up in doing some other research that I'm working on, because I thought that, you know, to hear something like that on mainstream news is I think, rather interesting. I mean, you may right. hear it. You may hear it on alternate websites, news websites, but to hear it, you know, on CNN and on Fox News, I thought that was pretty dramatic, and yeah. I think they even rolled out Bill Nye, the science guy, that was even a comment, if I'm not mistaken. But to go back to your statement earlier, you know, stating that these objects appear when you least expect them, I would also add, in many cases, by those people that least expect them, because so mm-hmm. many witnesses I've talked to told me, prior to seeing this object or this UFO, I never gave UFOs a second thought, right. or I thought UFOs were a joke. Yeah. It's amazing how many former skeptics have actually witnessed UFOs. Mm-hmm. And the police officers, going back to the January 5th investigation, interviewing the witnesses, their fellow police officers were laughing and joking about it. And, you know, were saying, you know, well, if I saw it, I wouldn't report it. And the police officers said, look, you know, I saw something. I don't know what it was, but, you yeah. know, the other officers saw it as well. So I'm not alone. I think we always, unfortunately, in our society, we make UFO synonymous with flying saucer. It's like, mm-hmm. no, it's a genuine unidentified yeah. flying object. That's all we're saying.
Yeah. And people need to keep that in mind. They need to remember that sometimes there are things that, you know, aren't identified. It doesn't necessarily mean that it's extraterrestrial. It's just
Absolutely.
Something that we can't identify.
Absolutely.
Anytime you have... once you learn of a technology, that means it's been around for a while. So the fact that we're now learning about their ability to cloak to that extent means that they've had this technology for at least 10, maybe even 20 or 30 years, and we're just exactly. now finding out about it.
Exactly. You know, and they often say within the aerospace world that, you know, aircraft usually have a shelf life of maybe 5 to 10 years before, mm-hmm. you know, they're able to be detected, or before they moved on to the next generation of aircraft. And I was asked a while back about this January 5th case with these police officers, and I think it was roughly 2012, maybe 2010. And so it was 10 to 12 years after the sighting. And, mm-hmm. and I kind of forecasted or predicted that, you know, this might have been something military. But if we go another 10 years or 15 years or 30 years and the Air Force has not rolled out a triangular spacecraft or triangular aircraft, then I think we need to ask ourselves, what did these police officers observe? Mm-hmm. And again, when you take into account the historical cases, some triangular UFOs may be military. I can't say anything to the contrary with regard to that, because they certainly could be. But how do you explain the ones going back to the 40s, the 50s, and pre-World War II, and pre-powered flight? When you go back to 1881, what did these astronomers observe over the lunar surface? Two large, dark, triangular notches that were moving in basically unison with each other.
What could that possibly be in that time period?
In 1881.
Yeah.
So I think if you're educated, if you're even semi-open-minded, you have to concede that we may be dealing with someone else's technology in some of these reports. I think that's the safest thing we can say.
For some people, there's really no question, because some people know. When people have interactions with the actual beings, there's not a question in their mind. Well, on specific craft, some craft may be military, but the fact that there are craft that come from somewhere else, some people just know that because they've had experiences with
their personal experiences.
Right,
absolutely.
Exactly.
Yeah. It's, you know, what I'm trying to do is to convince the general public to at least take UFOs more seriously.
To open their minds up.
Not that they have to believe. I always hate the
right.
believe word. Because
I don't like that word.
I always tell people, I've actually, you know, kind of not chastised, but called out my audience in many cases. And I said, it really doesn't matter what you personally believe regarding UFOs. Right. It doesn't matter what I believe. All that matters is what we can document.
Yeah. I don't like the word believe. It just, there's a connotation to it. When you're talking about religious things,
it kind of has this religious belief, ideation feel to it. And I'm not interested in belief systems. I'm interested in documenting facts, looking for patterns, objectively analyzing the information, which, you know, as we all know, the skeptics out there, they don't analyze the data. They don't interview witnesses. In fact, one of the famous skeptics, years after this January 5th case, stated, these police officers, you know, they wanted to see UFOs. He never talked to these officers. I did. He doesn't, and yet he's psychoanalyzing these individuals without even having met them or spoken to them. I have no room for the skeptics any more than I have the UFO true believers. I think we need to be open-minded. I think we need to exercise our brains. I don't think we should just accept or reject everything at face value.
Right.
I think we need to be judicious in what we're looking at, look at the quality of the information, properly vet the information, because as we all know, there's a lot of noise out there in the data. There's a lot of liars. There's a lot of hoaxers.
Mm-hmm.
The history of UFOs has demonstrated that.
Multiple con
jobs, hoaxes, liars. And, you know, let's be honest, there are those people that are delusional,
right.
that maybe are not in their right minds that are reporting these things. I had one case, just a side note, when I was investigating cases in the St. Louis, Missouri area, I had one witness that claimed to have had abduction experiences.
Mm-hmm.
And during the course of a normal preliminary interview, I'm interviewing her, and I asked her, I said, well, you know, how big was this object that you said sat down near the house? And she said, well, it had to be at least 40 to 50 feet in size. And then we went out to the backyard, and there were other warning signs, let me just say, during the course of this interview.
Right.
But after we went outside, I said, well, you know, as any investigator, I asked, well, can I see where the craft landed? Oh, certainly. Let's go out to the back here, and it's around the house. There was another house right next door to hers,
mm-hmm.
and there was maybe an 8-foot, maybe, I would say 6 to 8 foot gap between the two homes. We were very close to each other, side by side.
Right.
She pointed to a small 4-foot patch of flower bed and pointed and said, that's where the object sat down.
Okay.
Now, unless you're Doctor Who and you have a TARDIS and you
right.
can manipulate spatial dimensions, how did you get the 40, 50 foot saucer into this little 4-foot square area?
Yeah, that's interesting.
So inconsistencies, and there were other warning signs as well. But,
yeah.
You know, things to look for. But, you know, when we go to conferences, we hear about the good cases. We hear about the cases that are properly vetted. What you don't hear about are all the the lunatic stories and all the inconsistencies that we often have to hear,
right,
and things of that nature. You know, I can't tell you how many times I've had reports of UFOs being sighted, and in one particular case, got a call from Peter Davenport at the National UFO Reporting Center. He said there's a gentleman, he and his son had been watching this object for about a half hour. I believe they're within 30 to 45 minutes of where you live. Is it possible that you could go out and try to see what these individuals claim they're seeing? Mm-hmm. He states that he's knowledgeable in astronomy. They've been watching the object, and it's highly anomalous. It's moving around. It's changing size, etc. I had just gotten in from the grocery store, of all things, so I threw the groceries in the refrigerator. I grabbed my laptop. I grabbed my my binoculars, and I got in the vehicle and I drove out close to where these mm-hmm. individuals lived, which afforded me a beautiful view and clear skies, nice bright full moon. And I called the individual up and I asked him, so I understand you're looking off to the, you know, the east, southeast. Yes, that's where we're looking. Okay. And I'm looking at the sky right now with you, you know, albeit, you know, some miles away. Where is the object relative to the moon? Well, it's just down and to the left in about the 8 o'clock position from the moon. Okay. And you've been watching this for how long? Well, we've been watching it now for probably hour and a half. Okay. And it was smaller, or it was larger earlier in the night, but now it's much smaller. Well, that immediately started to raise some concerns for me. So mm-hmm. I'm sitting in my vehicle. I'm looking through the windshield with my binoculars at this light. I pull up my laptop with my astronomy program in the exact same spot where these individuals are looking is the planet Venus.
Uh-huh.
And there was nothing else around that I could have mistaken or mistook for what they were describing.
Yeah.
And the fact that they said it was larger earlier at when it was lower on the horizon, well, that's due to refraction.
Right.
And it magnified it. And then as it ascended higher up in the sky, it took on a smaller appearance. But I had to break the news to him, and at first he didn't believe me, but I told him, I'm looking at the star charts. You know, the only thing that you're looking at, that I'm looking at, that is in that position in the sky, other than the moon, is the planet Venus. And I could still sense some skepticism, but I've had this happen more times than just a few. And I simply told him, I said, well, do me a favor. I want you and your son to come out tomorrow night, this time. And if you don't see that light there, if the skies are clear, then I want you to call me. If you see that same light in the same position in the same part of the sky, then it's Venus. And every time I've done that to someone, I never get a call back.
Yeah.
So there's a lot of noise we sift through, but there are some good cases, and there's a genuine phenomenon that definitely bears greater scrutiny.
Yes, most definitely. Actually, you know what? After show, I'm going to send you a link. My daughter actually took a video once, and there was debate on whether or not that was Venus, but it seemed to move through the clouds. We're not really sure about that one, so I'll have you look at that one and let me know if that was Venus or not.
Yeah.
But she actually did get one video once, and yeah, I've got it on YouTube somewhere, but I'll have to find it, but yeah, definitely. Marky? Did you have some questions? Because we're getting kind of low on time, and I know you said you had a couple of questions tonight.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, thanks for that, David. I had a look at your website earlier and watched a couple of your videos, which were very cool.
Yes.
There was, firstly, a question about what you've just been speaking about, your January 5th case, which yes. I think in one of the videos, as you say, was sort of the one that made your name as perhaps an investigator. I was wondering what the sort of line or chain of command was like, in the sense that, and how you've seen that change over the years as a reaction to these sightings, because perhaps if we went back 50 years after such a report, you know, the military might get involved, and then we might have men in black going around people's houses afterwards and stuff. But it sounds like there was not really any of that level of interaction after this event. Do you have any ideas why that doesn't really happen if the triangle UFOs themselves, for example, are as awesome and amazing as they ever were?
Well, specific to the January 5th case, Marky, it was interesting because it had, as we had discussed earlier, garnered a lot of St. Louis media attention. In large part because of the credibility of the witnesses, which I think Lenita alluded to earlier. And because I think there was such a heavy presence of media, if the military were going to interview or interrogate or threaten these witnesses to remain silent, I think that really created an uncomfortable situation in that respect, because the cameras were being trained on these witnesses. They were being interviewed, you know, ad infinitum, ad nauseum, by newspaper reporters, television news anchor people. And so I don't know if the climate was right where the military could step in and start interviewing without running the risk of, you know, drawing more attention to themselves. So at least in that case, I don't know of any military interest regarding the witnesses, you know, after the sighting. Other cases that I've interviewed, it's funny you mentioned that. There seems to be an absence of the, you know, men in black stories or levels of intimidation where people were told to remain silent with the triangular UFOs. So I'm not quite sure, you know, what that's all about. But as I've often said, it's a scarier proposition if militaries, not just the United States, but of course around the world, if military groups aren't looking at these triangular UFOs, to me, that's a scarier proposition than if they are. Because from a pure defense standpoint, if these aren't ours, I would certainly hope they're at least gathering the data, trying to figure out what's going on with these things.
True. Yeah, that would be good of them. But maybe it is up to us. Who knows? No, that's good. But on similar to that, but away from that a little bit, then what are the links that you personally do sort of follow? Or what I mean by that is, like, earlier on, or in one of the videos, you were, I think, mentioning how people, when they see triangular UFOs, sometimes they see them moving slowly and they're glowing red, and sometimes they're seen moving fast and glowing white. So that kind of speed and color is a kind of link I might look for in other things and want to know more about what that is. And the other one would be two UFOs. One of my favorite videos is of two UFOs sort of playing against each other, what I think you called cat and mouse in one of your videos. I call it just playing with each other. And you told us a couple tonight, like the fighter pilot that saw them split into two, and and this sort of relationship between one and another. I mean, that seems like a fairly important link that goes back a long way. Is that something you try to strive?
Yes, let me address the two triangles being observed, because this was a pattern that, to be quite honest, I did not know about until I started piecing together and looking at these reports. And going back to the Belgian wave, there was the account from the first night that really launched everything, November 29th, 1989, near Lake Gileppe, where two Belgian gendarmes observed one triangular UFO hovering over the dam. And as they were observing it, suddenly another triangle rose up behind some trees and seemed to be cavorting around the sky with the first object. And they were similar, identical, large, dark, silent, triangular objects. And I thought that was just an outlier, statistical outlier. I thought that was just, you know, an anomaly. But I found numerous reports going back decades where these triangular UFO objects, we actually talked about one earlier, the case from 1881. They didn't describe one triangular black notch over the lunar surface. They described two. And then there are other reports, numerous reports involving triangular UFOs that are either in pairs or in multiple groups. But it certainly seems like the two triangles flying together seem to be a pattern that bears out time and time again. And it's funny, I've often posed this as just a hypothetical. If Lenita is walking down the street and she suddenly sees a large triangular UFO, which I know she's probably wishing she could see, if she observes something like that, I would pose this to everyone listening. Is your first inclination to turn around and scan around you? Hey, I wonder if there's another one around. No, you're riveted by what you're seeing. So in many of these cases where people observe one triangular UFO, seeing this pattern play out, are there many other cases where the witness simply didn't look over their right shoulder to see another attendant object nearby?
Yeah.
So something to think about in that regard. As far as the patterning of lights, the primary pattern that we typically see are the stereotypical large white light at each point of the triangle. and a strobing or pulsing orange or reddish orange light in the center. That's the most common lighting configuration. But to your question, Marky, there are cases where in absence of lights, actual lights being observed, individual lights, a number of highly credible reports where I've interviewed witnesses describe where the object apparently was bathed in a colored light. In one particular case, I believe it goes back to 1980, in the state of Missouri, in Stanton, Missouri, near a KOA camp, there was a witness that observed a triangular object that had this bluish-white shimmering effect on the underside, and he said it was almost like an electrical arc that swept across the surface.
We're out of time. Thank you for being with us, David.
Thank
Unfortunately,
you,
yeah, we've got to go to break. When we come back, we won't be with David Marler anymore. We'll be right back, everyone.
Warning!
We gotta stop them! They're gonna kill us all!
See how the trouble you've started?
Be they the government, be they industry, be they organized labor, be they anyone, or human beings!
Time when the operation of the machine becomes so odious, makes you so sick at heart, that you can't take part, you can't even passively take part, and you've got to put your bodies upon the gears and upon the wheels, upon the levers, by all the apparatus, and you've got to make it stop, and you've got to indicate to the people who run it, to the people who own it, that unless you're free, the machine will be prevented from working at all.
Revolution Radio of freedomslips.com, the number one listener-supported talk radio station, throwing ourselves upon the gears of the machine. Revolution Radio, where information never sleeps.
You called down the thunder, well now you've got it.
Right, you tell them I'm coming, and hell's coming with me, you hear? Hell's coming with me!
Revolution Radio!
Government conspiracies, paranormal activities. Can I get fries with that, please? It's Anomalous Realities on Revolution Radio.
Welcome back, everyone. So really quick, I just want to do what we do every week, and I want to remind everyone that we are here on Revolution Radio, and you are enjoying Anomalous Realities because of Revolution Radio. So if you enjoy what you're hearing, and you like the show, and you want to keep hearing more of the show, just take a minute and visit the website. Click on the donate button and, you know, give them a small donation. You could buy a cup of coffee for $5 or you can, you know, help support the station. They also have seed packs that you can get. These are heirloom seeds, organic. It's a great way to support the station and also to get yourself something for your garden. And so with that, Marky has a game for us tonight.
Were you going to give David's website address? Because that ended very abruptly, unfortunately, didn't it?
It was a really good, didn't it?
Really good discussion.
No, it went, oh my goodness, it was way too quick tonight. We kind of ran out of time while he was still discussing, which is a terrible shame. However, he did have another engagement scheduled, and so we had to let him go. But yeah, if you guys would like to pick up his book, it's called Triangular UFOs. Sorry, I'm a little bit of a coughing fit earlier. Triangular UFOs, an estimate of the situation. And you guys, you can pick it up on Amazon. I think it's pretty much available everywhere. But you can also pick it up on his website, which is davidmarlerufo.com. Yeah. I just got to tell you guys, it's a really good book. There is so much more in the book than I could even possibly have gone over with him during the show. There is evidence in here that they've covered, like that case he was talking about, the January 5th episode in 2000. They've covered this story on multiple TV shows and things, but there is evidence that is in this book that you will never have seen on any of the programs that have talked about it. So he has got more evidence in this book than you will find on these other shows. So if you're interested in the UFO phenomenon, pick up his book, because you will find all kinds of interesting facts and information that you won't find anywhere else. You won't find anywhere else. So, yeah. And with that, we have to go into our next segment.
He does definitely sound like an expert.
He definitely is. I mean, he's been studying this his whole life. He's kind of dedicated his life to this, which, you know what I find funny is he hasn't seen a UFO yet, because usually when someone is this passionate about UFOs, it's usually because they've seen one. However, his sister saw one, and there were a lot of sightings near him growing up, so I suppose that is what spawned it, but he certainly has a passion for UFOs, so.
Yeah, he'll have to let it jump out at him at some point.
Yeah, definitely. I just wonder, you know, that's the.
The point I was.
Yeah.
Well, I didn't get to say to him earlier, but you know, misidentification—that's also good. That's healthy to experience, and you know, to be confused and to ask the questions, even if it does turn out to be something normal. I think that's good. One of the incidents I had, which I thought at the time was a classic triangle case, a huge craft thing went over me. But you know, 80% of it is like every triangle scenario, but there was 20% that I was able to back up with actual fact that it was just a plane I saw. But I think that was healthy to experience something, and maybe, but if I had not looked into that, I would have gone away from that and just believed that for the rest of my life. So you need the misidentification.
One of the things about that case was there were people that described it differently, and you know, there were those discrepancies that they thought, well, maybe, you know, maybe they weren't seeing the same thing, you know, maybe they all just were seeing an illusion, you know, because, you know, they have one person sees it and it's kind of not a full triangle. Another person sees it and thinks it looks like a rectangle. But what they actually found, and this is one of the things you'll find in the book, but the evidence suggests that there were multiple craft that were being viewed over that area at the time.
Well, I was going to ask, was Phoenix Lights, was not one of those a big triangle UFO?
It was a two-parter UFO. Yeah, that was.
That's more multiple witnesses than you can probably.
I know. I would have really liked to talk to him about that one, because I'm sure he's done a lot of research on it as well. But like I said, we ran out of time, so I think. I think we definitely want to have David back sometime when he has time. He's very, very busy, but yeah, I definitely want to have him back sometime.
So you want to play Topic Bot? You want me to load Topic?
Yes. Let's play a game.
Okay.
What is that horror movie?
Pre-activating subroutines. Launching 3D renderer. Connecting to AOL. Waiting. Still waiting. Success. Topic Bot is now connected and online, awaiting command.
Topic Bot. So he's going to say some stuff. First, you have to probably guess what is actually being said, and then, of course, just have a little discussion about it. So,
okay.
Enter command. Access reality. Oh no, delete reality.
Do we still have Topic Bot?
Interesting topic found.
Here we go.
All right.
He's a bit slow. He runs on Windows 95.
Hollow Earth.
That is an interesting one. Melina, what are your thoughts on Hollow Earth? Oh my goodness. That is a good topic.
I believe definitely that there are things within the earth that we don't know about, especially within the water, within the earth.
Really?
Yes. So
I've heard the idea that there's like another sun inside the planet, like a second sun that allows, you know, an entire ecosystem, which there has been some evidence of. There's that cave in Vietnam that's been found that has a jungle inside of it, which is phenomenal. Have you ever seen?
Yes, I have.
Yeah, isn't that amazing?
Mm-hmm. It sure is.
Absolutely amazing. So yeah, Admiral Byrd, here's one of those things that go along with the Mandela effect. You know, the flight of Admiral Byrd, where he went into a hole, he flew into a hole at one of the poles. But here's the thing. I'm finding a lot of websites saying that he flew into, it was a mission at the South Pole. Now, I always remembered it being the North Pole.
Yeah, there's probably conflicting evidence because Admiral Byrd, I believe, did actually have to do, specific army duties or Air Force duties down at the South Pole because that's where they thought there was Nazi stuff going on, is the impression I got. But you're right, the hollow earth, sort of him traveling into it, because I think that was on a different kind of mission. I don't think that was...
Not the same mission, maybe.
Well, not related to this. You know, there were two different Nazis down in the southern area and just charting land up at the top or whatnot. So. But yeah, Admiral Byrd, he's an interesting one because he is this actual military figure, but the admissions that he made, they're a bit weak, maybe. I mean...
Well, I don't know. I mean, when you think about it, the civilization that he claims exists inside the planet would explain some of our UFO phenomenon because this civilization predates ours. So they're much more technologically advanced than we are. It's curious.
It's curious. And you're absolutely right. I mean, there's evidence to suggest that our modern day UFOs do go up to the North Pole or maybe even the South Pole or whatnot. So...
haven't we had a lot of reports of UFOs going into volcanoes?
Yes.
The oceans.
And the oceans, which might be an entrance to the inner planet. Correct me if I'm wrong, guys. Do you remember for sure? But didn't he say that they were Aryan in nature, right? So they were pale, blonde, blue-eyed. But weren't they also extremely tall? Do you guys remember that? Whether or not they were normal height?
I don't know.
It seemed like he said they were really tall.
I can't remember his account exactly, but yeah, that fits the sort of Nordic alien thing, doesn't it?
They say the Pleiadians are very similar in description to the people that he encountered in Hollow Earth, which is interesting, I guess, in itself. But there have been lots of large skeletons that have been found lately. And the Smithsonian has admitted openly that they have intentionally lost very large skeletons over time because they were trying to cover up history that, you know, doesn't go with the Orthodox teachings.
A bit like NASA losing all the moon landing
footage. Yeah, exactly. Isn't that convenient?
Isn't it just? Okay,
yeah, right.
Shall we ask Topic Bot for another one?
Yes.
Okay.
Scanning reality now.
Thing you got, Mr. Bot?
Alert. Interesting topic found.
With
Area 51.
Oh, okay.
Another big one.
Yeah, definitely. Well, you know, my take on Area 51 is that it isn't what it used to be. I think once upon a time, Area 51 may have been a top secret facility where things were kept. But because it has become known, therefore, there has to be a secondary place now where everything that they thought was going on at Area 51 is now going on. Because they wouldn't just leave it there. Once the secrecy of something is divulged and they've lost that air, they're not going to continue to keep things there that perhaps they don't want people. Because how many times have people tried to get in there, you know?
Well,
it's very heavily guarded, but...
was Area 51 ever the destination for what was... When I think of Area 51, I don't think of the secret base where they might be keeping top secret stuff. I think of the crash. I think of the Roswell crash when I think of Area 51.
Now, why do you make that correlation?
I make that correlation because Area 51 was the closest place to respond to the Roswell crash. And that is what made Area 51 the Area 51. But there are how many other areas? Where's Area 1? Where's Area 2? Where's Area 12?
Well, you know, the thing is, well, I've told you guys before, my mother-in-law worked for the Pentagon for many years when it was the War Department. And she told me that when Roswell crashed happened, that they took them originally, and this isn't documented this way, so I only have her word for this, but that they were originally taken to a hangar at White Sands. There was an Air Force base at White Sands, New Mexico, and they were taken there, and the beings were just laid out on a slab there because they were waiting for orders on what they were supposed to do with them, because it was the first time they actually, you know, had beings, so they didn't know what to do with them. Could they have taken them to Area 51 and not, you know, somewhere else from there, you know, and a different story? Yeah, that may be. But what she had told me was that Area 51 was not always called Area 51. It had a different name back then when Roswell happened, and I don't remember what she called it, but it had a different name at the time. She said it wasn't Area 51 back then. So I'll have to look into that and see what there is to that, because she's told me a few things over the years, and she's limited in what she could tell me, even as she's passed away now, so they can't do anything to her. But
we've got Dreamland, Paradise Ranch, Home Base, and Watertown, it's been known as.
It was like a section something. No, it was like section something or something like that. I don't know. But yeah.
But that's an interesting theory. Area 51's got you looking in one direction, whereas maybe it's going on in another.
Yeah, I think originally they were doing things there, but once the cat got out of the bag, they had to move operations. And they have backup upon backup upon backup. I don't think it was ever the only place that they were doing research and experiments on extraterrestrials that they had come across. I'm not even 100% sure that we hadn't had any interactions to that point, although, you know, it's possible because it could just be that they didn't have any protocols at that point in time.
Mm-hmm.
But now, I'm thinking about, what was his name? Dulcy, the guy that helped with Dulcy that was killed. He was murdered. You guys know who I'm talking about?
Bill,
yeah.
What was his last name, though?
I can't remember it now. Isn't that horrible?
Phil Schneider.
Phil Schneider. Excellent. Thank you so much. But yeah, you know, the things that he talked about that were happening at Dulcy suggest that there was interactions between the government and these beings that the base was being, you know, kind of, that were living there, and the base was kind of being built over. But that was, what, in the 90s or something, or the 80s? Was it the 80s? When was that base being built?
Not too sure, but isn't there a similar sort of one? Was it Dallas Airport, which everyone speculated had a huge...
Denver.
Denver Airport, and it had all those sort of Holocaust images or something.
Yeah, it does. And they have these catacombs, I guess. They're not catacombs, but there's these tunnel systems built under the airport.
Well, Google, all I can see about Dulce, if that's how you pronounce it, is Google says, so perhaps did the advanced civilization that originally built the Dulce base. So I don't know if I want to click this link.
Oh, my goodness.
Reptoids.com. Okay. No,
Reptoids. No. Reptilians, yeah. You know, that's something I wanted to mention earlier when we were talking about the invisibility technology, is people need to understand that if we have the invisibility technology, where do you think we got it from? So, you know, when you have people experiencing sightings and craft where some people see it and other people don't, don't you think it's possible that they are limiting who they reveal themselves to in some cases?
Possibly, but it's like that other thing that you mentioned last week or the week before about maybe some people just don't vibrate on the right level.
Yeah. But I think there is a cloaking thing that goes on. My children had an experience, my daughters, about, I think it was about 4 or 5 years ago. One of them was resting on the bed and the other one was reading next to her. And she looked up and she saw what she could only explain, like, you know, the Predator movies, the way you could see Predator, but it was kind of like it was camouflage, but when it moved, you could kind of tell it was there.
Yeah. Okay.
She saw something over her sister like that. And then,
oh, how terrifying.
When the thing saw that she was looking at it, it pulled back and its eyes got real wide looking at her. And then she was frozen, like she couldn't move. And she was afraid what it was going to do. It finally released her and she literally grabbed a blanket and pulled it up over her head because she was scared. And that's like a child, you know, one of those things that kids do, like when you're scared of something, you pull the blanket. That's what she did. And when she pulled it down, it was gone. And then one of her, her oldest brother knocked and came into the room. And she said, when he opened the door, she saw it go out, but nothing since then. But that was the only case. And,
is that not similar to what people experience, like the figure over them when they've had sleep paralysis or something?
Yeah, it might be. I mean, she didn't say, you know, like the one that was awake said she couldn't move, but that is one of the things, is like, you're awake, but you can't move. Doctors will try to claim that you're in between wake and sleep, but I know I've experienced it at times when I know I wasn't asleep and I wasn't in between. I went from, you know, being fully awake to just being in that state, and it wasn't good because that was actually an experience with a shadow being when that happened. And yeah, that I actually felt like I was going to die in that moment because it shook me, which is, I've never heard of another situation where a shadow being actually physically, you know, would assault someone. But my daughter, my oldest daughter, has actually been assaulted by a shadow being as well. So they do attack. So people who say, oh, shadow beings are okay, I don't ever feel anything negative from them. We need to do a whole freaking show about shadow people, honestly, because there is so much information about shadow people, so much to talk about on that topic. We could do a whole show about that.
You've probably been beaten by CBS. When shadow people attack.
Well, now that I've put it out there, yeah, somebody knows it.
That's it. Hey, Lenny, to lots of money. She'll write it for you. Okay, let's scan reality for another one.
Reality, please stand by.
Topics.
Alert. Interesting topic found.
There you go.
Pokemon Go.
Oh my gosh. Oh, I'm literally face palming right now.
Did you just say did that say Pokemon Go?
Yes.
Well, listen to this version.
Pokemon Go.
It's really hard to get it to fit.
That one's a little bit of a better topic, I think.
Pokemon. Mon Go.
I thought you said Pokemon.
Pokemon. But I mean, this is a huge fad. We've had Americans finding dead bodies. Two Californians fell off a cliff because of it the other day.
Oh, my God.
What's going on?
It's the zombie apocalypse. It's here.
Have either of you got it? Have you used
no,
it?
No, I won't touch it.
No, I don't. I have no clue what the fad is about. You have to explain it to me.
Okay, it's, you know.
Go ahead.
I'm going to tell you guys something right now, because I read an article that the person that developed Pokemon Go is affiliated with the CIA. Okay. And there are permissions that you have to give to the application that gives you full access to all of your Google accounts. The app has access to everything, all your emails, all of your data, everything. It also lets you know that it will give authorities information on your location and your child's location whenever it deems it needs to. Okay, so this application is an extreme violation of privacy, and people are willingly subjecting themselves to it. I wouldn't do it. But, you know, I think people have gotten so used to just agreeing to terms anytime they put anything on their phones that they just throw caution out the window anymore, you know. And so they're really just haphazard. And I know it's done some good things. In some cases, there are children that are autistic and in situations like that where they have social anxiety disorders that they're getting out and they're interacting with people. So in some ways I can find that this has been good, but it's also, it's not.
There's an underlying data mining going on perhaps.
Right.
Yeah. Well, I mean, if you use the internet, you pretty much agree that something of yours is going to go somewhere, some data of yours. But you're right. You're absolutely right. I mean, they're not saying it's sinister with sinister intent, but yes, that's probably absolutely true. They're probably collecting tons of data. But at the very least, they can sell to the companies that will ring you up at 6 o'clock at night trying to sell you stuff.
All right, before we go into another topic, really quick, I have to choose a winner. Okay, we've had, through Twitter, we've had a contest going on. I've got copies of my new audiobook, The Frequency. It's available on audio. And I've been running a Twitter contest. And with this contest, the people that I choose will each get a free copy of the book. And so I'm going to be picking two people a week. And I just chose @AmazingJoe_TGS. So congratulations, AmazingJoe_TGS. Yay, you're going to get a free copy of the audiobook, The Frequency. Let me get this so that I can put that down there and I will notify him. And now we'll pick one more person. And @Mia_UK_. So congratulations, Mia. And congratulations to Joe. Yay.
Yay.
Okay. And next week, we will be picking new winners. If you want to get in on the contest, you just go to my Twitter, which is twitter.com/NitaWho. And you just follow me. And then at the top of the page, there is a tweet that is pinned to the top of my page. Retweet that, and then that gets you entered. And then every week I will pick two winners until I run out of codes. So now we can go back to our topic bot, our clever, scary.
You're listening to Anomalous Realities with Lanita Elder, Marky Mint, and Mel.
Okay. Yes, there is one or two more topics, I think, available. So.
Alert. Interesting topic found.
Okay.
Do tell.
Stargates.
Stargates. Nice, nice topic. I like this one. Okay. So are we going to talk about the TV series, or are we going to be for real?
No, go ahead.
Go ahead, Mark. I think that's the thing did the film come first, or did the discoveries of a real Stargate come first?
You know, that's a good question. So what evidence is there of Stargates? Because I remember on ATS, there was a huge mega thread called Stargates Are Real, right? Now, I know the person was promoting a book that they had written about it. I don't know the name of the book or the name of the author, but did you guys follow that thread? Do you know anything about, you know, what their arguments were as far as the fact that Stargates were real?
Well, supposedly that is the entire reason why we went to war in the Middle East, is really? Because we were looking for or trying to gain control of the Stargate that is located there.
Oh, yeah, that's right. They think there's sort of 4 or 5 big Stargates around the world, don't they? That thread was suggesting. Something like that.
Something to that effect.
Did they present any evidence to support it?
Well, that's questionable, I think. did anyone mention finding anything during the war on Iraq or anything? No. So whether evidence of that was found, probably unlikely not. But, you know, I kind of like that topic because I live not far from Silbury Hill in the UK, which is amongst, you know, UFO or just believers, woo-woo believers, including me. I'm one of those. you know, this is apparently a stargate, this ancient hill.
Really?
And the reason TopicBot, not me, came up with that topic is that, you know, it could also maybe link into wormholes. And I was going to maybe ask David a question sort of about that. But because we often look at, think of, you know, we stargates are either this thing which teleport us, but there could be this wormhole element. And do UFOs use wormholes or stargates, things like that? It's and Hollow Earth. I mean, that's that in itself. Could be a stargate.
Perhaps that's that makes some sense. That's very interesting. There, you know, we were talking about that one stargate, quote unquote, that was in Peru when Brian Forrester was on a couple weeks ago. Remember?
Yep. And that could be as Mel was saying. Did the movie come first or the phenomena?
Mm-hmm. I think the phenomena came first.
Yeah. But can't remember is if like ancient peoples were calling it a stargate, but they presumably were.
There was a name. I'm trying to remember because there was a name for that gate that they have in Peru. And I can't remember exactly what they called it, but people would use it to go between this world and somewhere else, whether it was to another dimension or to another world. It was definitely some sort of a portal or gate, and that is how it was described, but only
a doorway in the Hayumakra marker is what I'm getting here.
Okay. And but only certain people, only like their spiritual people were allowed to go through it and interact with the beings from other places, and they would come back with messages or things.
Well,
kind of like a shaman, actually.
So you go through stargates, do you?
No, I don't. But I will. I will. If there's one near me, I'll be happy to go through it. I would welcome an interaction on that level, most definitely. I've spirit walked to different places, but I have not physically gone through some sort of stargate, no. But that is definitely an interesting...
If it was a one-way trip only? Would you do it?
No.
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 No, maybe. Don't know. No.
It depends on if I had to go alone, I suppose.
What if you didn't know whether or not it was a one-way trip or not? Would you take the chance?
I probably would, yeah. I probably would. I don't know if I'd want to go alone, though. That's the thing. I don't know that I'd want to go alone. I think people should go, well, kind of like, you know, the series, people should go in groups if they're going to go through for, you know, all types of reasons. You know, you need a group of people to perform different tasks and do things. You never know what you're going to encounter on the other side. You don't know what's going to happen. So you need people of different types to go in a group to make sure you've got, you know, everything taken care of, just in case.
But sadly, there are still no active stargates that we know of.
Yeah. I see a story it says CNN.com, but I don't think it's actually CNN. It says ireport.cnn.com. Actually, it is. It says Iraq Stargate key to 911 and Bush. Yeah, I did see your story. And this is on CNN.
I remember reading that.
Yeah, so it says on December 12, 2011, Boris Chertok, engineer, one of the first manned missions to space for the Soviet Union, died at 99. The U.S. intelligence complexes and the U.S. military complexes hope all of the eyewitnesses to the secret space program will die off before they have to tell the truth. Now, this is CNN. This can't be. It looks like CNN. It looks like CNN.
It's fake news.
It's got to be fake
news. It's been hoaxed.
I don't see CNN covering this story. But it looks like it's CNN. I don't know. You know, you guys, if you guys want to look at it, it says ireport.cnn.com/docs/doc-719922. So.
/virus.
Probably.
That sounds good. Good. Okay. So we've done Stargate. Should we do one more topic?
Yeah, let's do one more.
Okay. One more.
Alerts. Interesting topic. Found.
Okay.
Found. That thing you wear, they tried to make his ship go back in time, but some of the crew got fused to the ship, and they were all like, Ark, oh no, I've space-time melted into a boat.
The Philadelphia experiment.
Yeah! Well done. Well done.
Yeah. Oh gosh, that was...
That time travel-lings experiment.
That is one of those things. I mean, I don't know how much, you know, you can actually know about this other than the rumors, you know, because it was top secret. I don't even know, you know, after the fact of, you know, having things disclosed, how much we're going to know. But it's certainly, that was one of the first times that they were experimenting with trying to make a craft invisible. That was the idea of the experiment. They were trying out a cloaking technology is what apparently they were trying to do with this experiment. And what they ended up doing was very, very different. At least that's, you know, that's how the story goes. That's, yeah, that was, it made an interesting film actually too, didn't it?
There are a couple of films. Mm-hmm. If you want to call them interesting, that's cool. But I think they've got about as decent IMDb rating as the new Ghostbusters. that's cool.
No, that came out tonight, didn't it?
It's been out a week now, I think.
Didn't I thought roughly. It was this week that it was coming out, the 15th.
It's maybe it came out UK first. It would have been whatever they call what matinee or something, maybe performances.
Yeah.
But
yeah,
it's
it could be pre-release. Oh, they always have those out in California. You know, you get to pre-screen films before they come out, which is nice.
And, well, that's the thing. Maybe that Philadelphia experiment, it was only good for being a movie at some point. And there was not much else more to it. Was that not connected to Tesla at all?
Yeah, I think they were messing with Tesla technology.
Hmm.
You know, they tried to steal everything. Well, they basically did steal all of his research. It's said that he has hidden journals somewhere that have never been found. It would be interesting to see those come to light someday.
That's it. But I wonder if they still have any of the technology still going. Was it you maybe on Facebook posted like a sort of harp story of somewhere where it produced these strange clouds? Quite recently, I've seen that.
I'm not sure if that was me, but I have posted a few stories about Tesla.
Where that technology and if those experiments, I'm sure they tried something, definitely. Where that has gone, it's sort of almost a bit of a shame that we don't see or hear of any of that anymore. If it's done all under wraps.
Well, a lot of his technology they wanted to suppress and keep to themselves because it was free energy.
Yeah.
You know, okay. The wealthy don't want to put things like that out.
Right? No.
That wouldn't be good for them because they have to keep their status, you know, and they have to keep people down. And if there's free energy, you know.
But there was also, maybe again, you mentioned in a previous episode that some people, maybe Polish or Russian guys, were trying to build a new Tesla tower.
Yeah, we were talking about that, and I think they had some success, if I'm not mistaken. But you know, that's not going to last long. I mean, we've got to get to a point where the people have more power than the elite, so that we can do things about this when it happens. Like there's these new cars. I think I did share that run on air, air cars, and so that's just like, you know, the ultimate way, you know, to bypass the oil companies and everybody else that's trying to get money out of vehicles. It's not even electricity now. It's air. It's freaking air.
Yeah. A lot of public transport runs on poo.
Well, they'll try to bill you for air now, won't they? We own the air. You have to buy your rations of air. How crazy of a world would it be if we actually got to that point? I don't even want to envision a future where that actually happens.
Oh, but you know that they would try to.
They would.
They're already trying to do a carbon tax, you know, just because you live.
Wow.
They want to tax you.
Wow. Speaking of taxes, oh gosh. So where are we at with the presidential election races? We have Bernie Sanders saying that he's endorsing Hillary, right? Which is in itself just kind of ridiculous. But they're still saying that he hasn't fully, like, you know, conceded to her. Like, he's still in the running. I'll tell you who my vote is behind now. There's actually a website that will help you align your views with campaign, you know, with people's campaigns. And mine are aligned with Jill Stein, who is the Green Party candidate. And so I'm going to vote for Jill Stein. I was putting my support behind Gary Johnson, but there's a lot of things that I don't really agree with on his political lines and just, you know, where he lines up. So I am going Jill Stein. I'm not going to make any apologies for that because I won't vote for the lesser of two evils, and I'm not going to accept that I'm throwing away my vote, because once we see that way, that's everything that's wrong with our system right now, is believing that we have a limited choice when we don't. So the website that will match you up is called Open Campaign, and I don't know if it's opencampaign.com, but you go there and you fill out a questionnaire, and then it will show you where you stand on issues and where these candidates stand on the issues, so it will actually accurately align you up with the candidate that you know, their views and their values most align with your views and values. So yeah, I'm with Jill Stein now.
Sorry to be the only non-American here, but when will be new president time?
When next year. But we have the elections in November. The election is in November, but they turn it over to him next year.
Right. So still a little while to decide then.
Still a little bit of time to decide. Still time for people to get more information. That's why, you know, I try to help remind people that we don't have to choose just Hillary, you know, or Trump.
Trump. Totally. Trump. Well, as you see in the UK, we've had a big political shift and
how's that going for you guys?
I think it's very interesting. It's you know, it's the political class pretty much, you know, bitch whining, I don't really know how to say that any other way, and acting childish, but you can tell that they've you know, career politicians have had sort of their ideals ripped away from them, perhaps for a little while, maybe completely. I don't know. It's just good. It's, thank God, you know, there's a bit of a change in the way this is. Whether it's probably just going to go back to that, yeah. But as you say, hopefully that shows other people, as much as everyone's probably getting angry about Brexit still, but at least it shows you that, you know, change can happen, maybe positively, maybe not. Yeah. I don't know. But it can happen. And as you may have read tonight, this is slightly unrelated, but I mean, there's other stuff going on in Turkey now. With like they're trying to overthrow the government tonight. Something.
Really?
Read about that. Yeah, there's a coup going on.
No, I did not.
Some section of the Turkish military have tried to take over the government tonight. So it's all going well out there politically.
Well, I'll send some positive energy to Turkey and to Paris.
Yeah, and then vote Trump. No, don't.
No.
Should we play one final game?
Yeah, don't you have another game?
Yes. Yes. This won't take long. Okay. So it's Guess the Creep.
Okay.
Yes, the creature.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. After each clue, yourself and Mel, you get to take one guess, but only one guess. Okay.
All right.
So, all right. Here's the first clue.
Some have seen me as I lumber about from tree to tree.
Some have seen me as I lumber about from tree to tree. One guess each?
Huh.
Whatever's on the top of your mind.
Cave creature? I don't know. No.
Jersey Devil?
Okay, that's all right. No, neither of you correct, so next clue.
Okay.
I can primarily be found in the Pacific Northwest.
Where that is, so that's one for
Bigfoot.
You. Bigfoot. Say that again?
Bigfoot. The Sasquatch.
Correct. This creature
really?
Was Bigfoot.
Yay, Mel wins a point.
I thought you meant like something that was up in the trees.
The final clue. This was the final for that one.
Some might say I have large feet. Can you guess who me is yet?
So we'll move on to the next.
Okay.
Yes, the creature.
Okay, let's. Clue one.
I first attacked in 1995. 8 sheep were discovered dead because I ate them.
Chupacabra?
Yeah, that's what my guess to chupacabra.
Correct.
Yay!
This creature was El Chupacabra.
Ta-da!
Well done. The clues were...
Some people call me the goat, sucker of Puerto Rico.
A clue, and
I have a Spanish name, and whether I actually exist or not is anyone's guess. Do you know who I am now?
Well done. So that's a point. That's 2 points to Mel and 1 to Lenita.
Yeah.
But on to our last.
I'm a stumpy being. I have a long neck and I like to point skyward.
E.T.
Correct. This creature was E.T.
Yay!
The extraterrestrial.
He wants to phone home.
Well done, you got it.
I was directed by Steven Spielberg, and I have a domestic lifetime gross of over $435 million.
You, I guess?
Pretty decent.
This one time, at band camp. Well, actually, it was just some kid's house. I wanted to phone home. Can you guess who I am now?
Well, that was it. You managed to guess the creature. You drew, though. God damn it.
You gotta make him harder.
Yes, the creature.
There are no more silly games now. I'm sorry.
Oh, that's all right.
That was fun.
Yeah, that was very fun. I very much enjoyed that.
Next time, we'll try and guess more.
Yeah, definitely. That was so much fun. I like that. Now, I found an article, Marky. And this is apparently, this is a recent article, but it was about something that apparently happened back in 2009. And it says a British cop witnessed tall white aliens inspecting a fresh crop circle.
Yeah, that sounds like along the A4, the Avebury incident. I don't know if that was 2009, but that does sound similar. Mm-hmm. There was a case where about 5 or 6 a.m. on a summer's mm-hmm. morning, I think, a policeman stopped at the side of Silbury Hill,
mm-hmm.
Where there is typically a crop circle every year. And saw 3 tall beings in a field. This might be that story.
Yep,
and,
that is it.
He sort of witnessed them, got out of his car to have a look, and they sort of moved away at very odd, you know, just sort of floated away through the crops. That piqued my interest. I then went and had a look at the crop circle, mm-hmm. not that year, but maybe the year after that happens on that hill.
Yeah.
And that's still one of my favorite places. I think if me personally had any chance of proving aliens, I would start probably where that crop circle happens every year, because that's either going to answer that someone's doing it, someone else like human is doing it,
right,
or an alien is. I mean, you've got a spot in the UK where this phenomena happens without fail every year.
Hmm.
So like, that's the perfect opportunity. And have I taken it? Have I? Beep. But yes, so what caught your eye on that one then? Or you just wanted to know
The fact that it was a British cop, I mean, I had not actually heard of, you know, an authority figure in the UK, you know, besides the military, because there was that one incident over there.
Yeah, well, you have Rendlesham, yeah. But no, you're right. This was a good one for a policeman. It made the papers and everything. And he didn't really want to be identified, if I remember rightly.
Yeah, that's what it says, is that he's an unnamed police officer who said it was a personal matter. But he also said that at first he thought they were forensic officers because they were dressed in white coveralls. They were all over 6 feet, had blonde hair, and appeared to be inspecting the crop circle. He also said that he heard what he believed to be a sound somewhat like static electricity, like a crackling noise, that seemed to be running through the field, and that apparently the crop was actually moving gently close to where the noise was. Now, that reminds me of when Barbara Lamb was on the show, she had mentioned something about some of the crop circles possibly being created by sound waves. So that would be an interesting thing, because, you know, he said that there was that sound like static electricity, and that there was movement, you know, there during the time. So that would be interesting, you know, if that would make a little bit of sense if that was related to how it's actually done. That's why there's, you know, no breakage, you know, to these, and it's so controlled.
Completely. Have you been to a crop circle?
No, I have not. I'd love to go someday. I have not been to one yet.
There aren't
as many here as there are there.
Yeah, exactly. For some reason, we have Wiltshire is just a hotspot of the earth for crop circles. So we're very lucky for that. And I don't know. I've lived next to wheat or corn fields most of my life. And yeah, when you look at the wheat or corn, whatnot, of a crop circle, something that is not right.
Do you think it has anything to do with, like, ley lines? Is there an interesting, you know, flux in the Earth's magnetic field where you...
Well, again, we have two big ley lines, the St. Mary and the St. Michael line, which run through my town at a very sort of sacred hillside. And if you were to follow the ley lines, and even if you just follow a path, which takes quite a big detour around, but that ends up at Avebury, at around this place where this supposed ley line energy would be. But in the same manner, we do live in a very small country, on a small island, so it's kind of hard to tell if a lot of this ley line stuff is sort of coincidence. But no, I like that. I like that stuff. And yes, I would say it has every chance of being connected, if it's for reals, to the energy found there. And as you say about the sound stuff, I mean, well, again, some of us speculate that Stonehenge, not too far from there, you know, was maybe moved through this use of resonance or whatnot. And
Which makes sense.
There's those things in maybe Peru, I can't remember, where, you know, these blocks have been cut like lasered and then moved up and down. I think I saw that on Ancient Aliens. Moved around like through the use of sound and stuff. Why should crop circles not be any different?
Yeah. I agree. It makes perfect sense. I mean, that seems to be a technology that is a very handy technology and a very, useful tool for many things. And yet we don't use it near as much. And I don't know if it's really that we don't have the understanding that we need, or I guess it's something that we've forgotten, because certainly the ancients had an understanding of it, or it would seem so.
Well, I'm no scientist, so don't quote me on this, but it's a bit like magnetism, is it not? I mean, we're still pretty primitive on magnetism and stuff. And, you know, our Earth is made of magnet, or is mm-hmm. a magnet.
Is magnetic, yeah.
Is magnetic. So we don't even have a very big grasp on that.
We have a magnetic field. I mean,
yeah.
We have our own magnetic field as well. Everything does, which if you know how to harness that, gosh, imagine the things that you can do. And that's, you know, that's what they say a lot of UFO craft, you know, that's what their propulsion is magnetic.
Certainly. And with sound, I mean, things like sonar and stuff, that's new technology for us.
Yep.
And we're only sort of, in recent years, learning more about how animals like communicate through sending a sound wave and that through the water and whatnot. So,
yeah. Well, it looks like we're out of time for this week already. So I'd like to thank everyone for listening tonight. And, you know, he's not here, but I'd really like to once again thank our guest, David Marler, for being with us this week. And Marky and Melina, thank you for being with us as well.
That's okay. Thank you.
And also, you guys, if you want to get in on that contest, you can also enter via Twitter, and you can also enter via Facebook. If you go to the Anomalous Realities page on Facebook, there is a post there that you can like the page and share, and that will also get you entered in the contest. So good luck to everybody, and have a wonderful weekend.
Goodbye.
Ancient aliens. Goodbye. Ghost busting. Palm reading, health and well-being. It's all here on Anomalous Realities with Lenita, Marky, and Mel. Over and out.